everyone. Welcome to Pearl River United Methodist Church on this beautiful July morning. I have just a couple of announcements for you all, especially given that I was not here last week. We all survived our trip to Redbird Mission in Kentucky. We came back with no injuries and only two flat tires. So, not mine. In our group, this past week, we had three different work sites. We replaced a tin roof, we did a kitchen floor, and we remodeled a bathroom. So it was a very interesting week with lots of joy and frustration, but it was a beautiful experience to be able to go and experience again what it is like to be able to serve our brothers and our sisters in Christ in other spaces. And so I look forward to bringing more of you with us next year. Additionally, you should have gotten my email, but I will lift it up for you again. The Friday before I left, we reset Episcopal assignments for Greater New Jersey. Greater New Jersey and the Eastern Pennsylvania Conference will continue to be affiliated under the new leadership of Bishop Cynthia Moore Kakoy, who is currently serving the Western Pennsylvania Annual Conference. She is a powerhouse, and I am super excited to be able to worship with her and for her to be our new bishop. So she will begin September 1st, and hopefully in the next couple of weeks, we will have some information about how we will welcome her, and I am excited to see where God is moving us in the next few months and years. Continuing on, next Sunday, we will be having a mini mission Sunday. So next week, we're going to focus on the thrift store and getting what we need to get done with Nifty Thrifty done. I hear we've already got racks on the wall. We've got other racks on their way. And we will be setting up for Vacation Bible School, because our Vacation Bible School begins a week from Tuesday, and we will go Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, 5:30 to 8:30 p.m., and there's a lot of setup that we're going to need, so many hands next week will make my light work, and we are thrilled about that. This week upcoming, we will have God by the Fire on Wednesday night. Friday evening is family game night at 6:30. And then a week from this coming Saturday, we are going to the Boulders game, woo, for Pink in the Park. If you have questions about how to get tickets through the church for that, let us know. It is a fundraiser, but also you get a benefit because of the package that we're getting. You get a whole $5 concession credit on your ticket, so you could buy a whole hot dog, and it'll be great. And we're just excited to be able to be together as a church doing something fun. Are there any other announcements that need to be made for the good of the order? Which one of you is doing this announcement? Which microphone do you want? That one. Okay, great.
Hi, good morning, everybody. I just wanted to bring the church up to date on some buildings and grounds issues. Some of you, if not most of you, may have heard we had a little lead exposure. Miss Georgia tested positive a couple weeks back, and we found the county came in to inspection, and we do have lead in the parsonage. The Buildings and Ground Committee, in conjunction with one board, has had several different contractors come in over the past couple weeks. We've got several prices. The one board has now committed to a contractor. At this point, we're looking at about a $33,000 remediation project. That's before any other problems that they find, why they do the remediation, and other work that's going to have to be done after all the remediation is done. Luckily, on the good news, as we've all been praying, Georgia's numbers have come down, so that's a little bit of good news we can all celebrate. One less stress for the pastor and her family. But you will be seeing something from the Finance Committee in the near future. We are working on some sort of lead drive Actually, we're meeting after service tonight to today to work on that. So I just want to bring everybody up and make them aware. I know there's been talk about the lead, but we haven't really made a formal announcement. But we do have lead in the parsonage, but it is, we now have a plan to correct it. And we'll keep everybody updated as it gets done. Thank you.
Thanks, Chris. Anything else? Nope. All right. Well, then I'm going to invite you to stand in body or spirit and join with us in singing our first hymn this morning. It's number 393 in your red hymnals or up on the screen, Spirit of the Living God.
Please remain standing as we do our call to worship. Who are you and why are you here today?
We have come to encounter Jesus Christ.
Do you feel his presence among you?
Yes.
We give God thanks for Jesus, who is always with us in spirit.
May your eyes be opened, your spirit led, and your hearts warmed today as you seek his face.
May our burdens be
You may be seated. Would you join me in our unison prayer this morning? O God of direction and guidance, we give thanks for your continual presence in our lives, especially in those times we are not sure which decision to make. Work within and around us so we experience clarity and peace as we seek to understand your purpose in our lives. In your everlasting love of us, we offer this prayer. Amen. Our next hymn will be Take Time to Be Holy, which is in the red book, number 395. If you would can rise in body or spirit to join us.
Thank you.
We're going to invite Timothy and his family to, so godparents and parents, to come on up. You guys can share. It will be fine. All right. And to my congregation, I'm going to invite you to open up to the baptismal covenant that is found on page 33. So if you take out your red hymnals and turn to page 33, you are going to be the bold parts. He's fine. It's okay. It's everybody's day, right? So, my siblings in Christ, it is through the sacrament of baptism that we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. All of this is God's gift offered to us without price. Will you tell us who we're baptizing today? Yay. So, to his parents and godparents, on behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? If so, say, I do.
I do.
Do you accept the freedom and power that God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? If so, say, I do. Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in his grace, promise to serve him as your Lord in union with the church, which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? If so, say, I do. Will you nurture this child in Christ's holy church that by your teaching and example, they may be guided to accept grace for himself, to profess his faith openly, and to lead a Christian life? If so, say, I will. And do you, as godparents or sponsors, support, will you, these candidates support and encourage him in his Christian life? If so, say, I will. And do you all, as the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ? Will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and life and include this person now before you in your care? And I invite us now to join together in professing the Christian faith as contained in the scriptures of the Old and New Testaments. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ?
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
And let us give thanks over the water. May the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Eternal God, when nothing existed but chaos, you swept across the dark waters and brought forth light. In the days of Noah, you saved those on the ark through water. After the flood, you set in the clouds a rainbow. When you saw your people as slaves in Egypt, you led them to freedom through the sea. Their children you brought through the Jordan to the land which you had promised. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Tell of God's mercy each day. In the fullness of time, you sent Jesus, nurtured in the water of a womb. He was baptized by John and anointed by your Spirit. He called his disciples to share in his baptism of his death and resurrection and to make disciples of all nations.
Declare his works to the nations, his glory among all the people.
Pour out your Holy Spirit. to bless this gift of water and those who receive it, to wash away their sins and clothe them in righteousness throughout their lives, that dying and being raised with Christ, they may share in his final victory.
All praise to you, eternal Father, through your Son, Jesus Christ, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns forever. Amen.
Are you going to let me hold you? Let's see. Hi. Hello. Yeah. That's A. Hi. Look, do you see this? Do you like water? Yeah. That's so cool, right? Yeah. Timothy Mark, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. May the Holy Spirit live and work and reign with you now and forever. Amen. Yay! Yay! That was easy, right? You did so good. It is now our joy to welcome our newest sibling in Christ. It is through baptism you are incorporated by the Holy Spirit into God's new creation and made to share in Christ's royal priesthood. We are all one in Christ. With joy and thanksgiving, we welcome you as members of the family of Christ. Members of the household of God, I commend to you this person before you, to your love and your care. Do all in your power to increase his faith, confirm his hope, and perfect him in love. We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love. As members together with you in the body of Christ and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church, we renew our covenant to faithfully participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus the Christ. So we're gonna make this really easy. I'm gonna have you guys just sort of shift this way, and I'm gonna invite everybody to stand up. And as you can, we're going to place a hand on Timothy, or if you're too far away, place a hand out, and we are going to pray. Good. Holy God, we give you thanks for Timothy and for his life that has already brought so much joy, and for the way, God, that you will continue to work in and through him. We pray, Lord, that he would always know that you are with him, and that you are always going to be with him. And God, may he come to know and love and serve you, and know that this congregation will always be a place of home and welcome and belonging. We pray that you would bless his parents and his godparents and his grandparents and all of those who come together to be his village. And may we be a small part of what helps make Timothy who you have called him to be. All this we lift to you in the name of your Son, Jesus the Christ. Amen. All right, everybody can be seated. You did great, Timothy. A plus. A plus. Scripture.
He's just so adorable. This morning's scripture reading comes from John chapter 3, verses 1 through 9. Now there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God." And Jesus answered him, "Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above." Nicodemus said to him, "How can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter the second time into the mother's womb and be born?" And Jesus answered, "Very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said this to you. You must be born from above. The winds blow where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the spirit." Nicodemus said to him, "How can these things be?" This is God's word for the people of God.
So this morning, we're starting a new sermon series on called On Purpose. And we're going to spend the next couple of weeks talking about essentially this question of why are we here and what is our purpose, which seems to be the eternal question that we're all trying to figure out, right? What is exactly is the point? And I asked myself over the last week multiple times, why am I here in Kentucky? Anyone who had a conversation with me before we left knew that we were sort of on the fence about whether or not this was our last year. There were some things that were happening that just, when the trip came back last year, there was just a lot of drama that occurred. And the question became, what is the purpose of what we do? And as I sat with my two co-leaders and we were trying to figure out how we take a group that we are used to being over 100 people filled with adults and young adults and youth, and so it creates for this really beautiful mix of people and there's always something going on and there's always a lot of joy, down to this group of 23 people, one young adult and three teenagers, who all asked me on multiple occasions, what am I doing here? Like, there are no other youth. When I first started going on the trip, we had 23 youth that went. So to go from large groups of people to this tiny little conglomeration felt weird. And not just weird, but is this right? And what in the world are we doing here? And as Steve, Connie, and I sat down to figure out what job sites people were going to go to and who was going where, we didn't have that much room to play with because we only had three work sites. And one of those spaces was a bathroom that was very, very small. So how many people are you really going to fit in this bathroom? And on day one, when my team showed up to the bathroom, everything from the toilet to the shower, which was maybe the space between right here and the floor, had completely fallen in. So there was no floor. How this woman's toilet was still standing, we are still to this day uncertain. And my team turned around and looked at me and said, why are we here? This seems a little bit out of our scope, because remember, the folks who go down on this trip are like me. I spend my professional life as a pastor. I do not spend my professional life as a contractor. I don't do anything in construction. I am not a plumber. I am just me. I know how to use power tools. That is about the scope of my capabilities. And somehow, we were supposed to finish this woman's bathroom in 4 days. And I will be honest, I spent a lot of time this past week internally thinking, why am I here? Why did I give up time with my child? Why did I decide to come? It felt like every day something, some other giant emergency or big issue showed itself. And I realized midday Wednesday that there was no way we were going to be able to finish this project because there were just too many things. And then Thursday midday, I'm sitting in this woman's shower pan that we had just installed, trying to put more of her floor in. And this woman, who was in her late 80s, who had some serious mobility issues, and who had not been able to walk into her bathroom for over a year, came walking by the door to see where we were and saw me sitting in her shower and started to cry. And 5 minutes later, we had 7 people in that bathroom. I still don't really know how we fit 7 people in that bathroom. And she came back in, and she was so overcome with emotion. Because the last time that she was able, she felt safe enough to actually be able to use the only bathroom in her house was over a year and a half ago. Was it pretty when we left? Absolutely not. Were we able to lay the linoleum? No. Were there things that people were going to have to go back in and finish and fix for us? Yes. Did I have a very long list of frustrations and headaches and a lot of moments where I was like, I could be home doing something that is not this, that is not giving me this much stress. And then I realized that despite all the things that I wanted to get done, this woman had not felt safe using her bathroom in 18 months. I want you to think about that. When was the last time that you thought about using your bathroom? And I don't mean like, oh, I have to go to the bathroom, but thought about the safety and whether or not you would fall into your floor when you went to go use the bathroom. That kind of security is not always guaranteed across the board in our country. So why were we there? We were there because this woman, God needed us to help this woman feel safe enough to be able to use her bathroom. Her son who lived with her also said to us as we were leaving, he said, well, if we ever get a storm that comes through here or there's a tornado or hurricane or something that we get hit, he goes, I'm going to stay in this bathroom because I think this might be the most secure place in the house right now. And we said, it absolutely is. We rebuilt floor joists. It was a whole process. But how often in our lives do we find ourselves in situations where we ask that question of what am I doing here? Because the frustration after frustration after frustration seems to pile on us. And you begin to wonder, what is the point? Does it matter what I'm doing? Will this cycle of frustration ever end? How many more things can we pile on? What else can God throw at us this year? And sometimes we're so caught up in the closeness of what's happening that we forget to do things like step back and look around. Because I will tell you, Thursday before she came walking into the bathroom crying because there were seven people in there, I was so angry. I said, I gave up a week of time at work. I gave up a week of time with my family. I left my daughter for the first time since she's been born. I gave up a lot of things to come here, and I'm not going to finish this project. And now this was year 18 for me of being part of this mission. And I was like, I've never not finished a project before. Anybody else who's like type A like that? Like when you start something, you have to finish it. And if you don't finish it, you're like, something is itching in my soul that I didn't do something right. And I was so angry that all of these other things had come together so that I couldn't get it done. That it took until we were still stressed out by the end, but it took Anne walking in and saying, I can't believe I finally have a floor I can walk on, to make me realize that it is not always about getting it done. For her, the last 18 months of her life have been terrifying. Think about, she only has one bathroom. When you don't feel safe enough to be able to use it because you are literally going to fall through the floor, the relief and the joy, and perhaps our purpose was a lot more than just finishing a job. Our purpose in life isn't always super clear. Timothy over here got baptized today, and he is 11 months old. Not one person in this room is going to tell us what Timothy's purpose is right now, other than to bring a lot of joy to his family. Yeah. We don't know who Timothy will be in 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, 50 years, 75 years, right? There's a long life that Timothy is going to live. And we have no idea what that's going to turn out to be. And we can hope and we can dream, but anybody who has had any interactions with children before know that it doesn't always work out the way you want it to. But today, we claimed that Timothy was one of us. That Timothy belonged in the family and the kingdom of God, no matter what Timothy's life winds up looking like. no matter what he brings to the table, no matter what he chooses to do in his life, that God already knows and claims and understands who Timothy is. God is already at work. And that this place will always be home. That he will always walk into the doors of this place today, tomorrow, in 6 years, in 60 years. This place will always be a source of belonging and comfort and home. It's not based on what Timothy will offer to the world. It is simply based on the fact that he is known and loved by his whole village and by God. So when Nicodemus comes to Jesus in the middle of the night trying to figure out what his purpose is, if he's followed all the rules enough, Jesus tells him he has to be born again. And in different denominations, you'll see different understandings of what born again is. But what Nicodemus is looking for is some sort of purpose. What does all of this mean? Who am I supposed to be? If I have done all of the things and if I have followed all of the rules, and for any of those really good children out there, right, there are certain people who are raised to identify with being good, right? I am a good child. There was very rarely ever a toe stepped out of place. We tend to function in a space that says we follow the rules, we get it right, and people will love us. And that is what Nicodemus is struggling with. I have done all of the right things, and yet something feels like it might be missing. What do I not understand? What do I not have? And what Jesus tells him is you have to be born again by water and the Spirit, which is being born anew into this belief and understanding that God does not call us because of what we offer to the world. God does not love us or accept us or want us to be part of God's family because of what we bring to the table, because of our degrees, because of our jobs, because of our finances, because of all of the stuff that the world tells us makes us successful, but simply because we are beloved children of God, which is completely countercultural to everything that our 21st century world wants to tell us. You don't ever have to be good enough to be loved by God. And so our purpose is not about fulfilling a certain recommendation of the rules or to be a certain kind of way. Our purpose is to be fully who God called us to be, which does not include a checklist of right and wrong. I was good. I didn't eat shellfish this week. Right? These are the kinds of things that Nicodemus is checking off. I didn't eat shellfish this week. I prayed the appropriate amount of times today. I have done my offerings. I have read scripture. I have listened to somebody else interpret scripture to me. Check, 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 check. Right, Timothy? Check, 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 check. He's fine. He's great. Nicodemus wants the answers for what makes me good enough. And our purpose is not about spending our lives to find those check marks. Our purpose is to find joy in the moment, to be so fully ourselves that we can't help but make people around us happy, joyful, that we can find within ourselves the thing that makes us the most connected to who we are, to who God called us to be. I forgot this week what it meant to be fully present because I was so focused on getting a job done that I didn't take the time to recognize and appreciate the love and the generosity that my homeowner was also offering to us. Now, where we serve in southeastern Kentucky is in the middle of Appalachia, where the poverty rates are almost 80% to 85%. When we're serving folks in this area, this is not an affluent space. Oftentimes, there is not extra money at the end of the week or the month or the year. And our homeowner sent her son to Manchester, which is about 35, 40 minutes away, which is the closest town, Okay, so why don't you just think about that. 35 to 40 minutes away is the closest town, to get us donuts from the Manchester Bakery. Because she said you can't come to rural this area, you can't come to Kentucky and not experience Manchester Bakery, which she's not wrong. It is one of the best bakeries. And she made sure to bring us donuts. And she told us, I just want you to be able to feel welcome in my house. Now, we are a group of invaders, quite literally, because I want you to think about me. Some of you have met my father before. He was on my job site, and we had three other people with us who are also not construction folks. My dad is the only one who has a construction job in that whole group. And here we were showing up to rip out this woman's bathroom and to see the most vulnerable spaces of her life, and she wanted to make sure that we felt like we belonged there. When was the last time that you were that concerned about the people in your life feeling like they belonged? That you were willing to make sacrifices to show them just how much they meant to you, even if they were just strangers? Because let me remind you, we showed up on Monday morning. She has no idea who we are. We are just these mostly Jersey folks who arrived and said, hi, we're here to rip out your bathroom. I would have shut the door in my face, right? If I showed up to your house and said, hi, I'm here to rip out your bathroom, you'd be like, no, ma'am. You have that MDiv. You do not have practical life skills. And yet, by the end of the week, everything had shifted. Our purpose is to not check all of the boxes. Our why am I here is to not spend our lives filling out the yes and the no boxes. Our purpose is to find what God has already called us to do, how God has already accepted and named and claimed us, even from the time that we are little babies, and to use that to make the world a better place, to serve one another, to love one another, to deeply connect with a God who calls all of us exactly as we are, to find a space of welcome and belonging and joy. Today and every day. Amen. Friends, at this time we are going to take our offering. And I would remind you all as we begin to take this offering, the church is not a place where people who have it all figured out come to talk together about how they've got it all figured out. This is a place for growing in our faith, walking beside each other in times of certainty and uncertainty, and asking hard questions so that we can learn to live more fully as the people we were created to be. When you give to Pearl River United Methodist Church, you are helping to create a space for growth, for change, for exploration. And so I invite you to give out of a space of generosity and expectation and not out of obligation this morning. I invite you all to stand in body or spirit for the doxology. Let us pray. Oh God, we thank you that you are not a God who stands still, but that you are always moving in our lives and in our church. Receive our offering today as a sign of our openness to wherever you are leading us next. Help us to continually grow in faith, purpose, and service. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Friends, I invite you to pass the peace to your neighbor. Peace. Friends, as you find your ways back to your seats, I'm going to invite you to participate in our second sacrament, Holy Communion. You may be seated. And I invite you to follow along with the bold parts. May the Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. We praise you, God, and we give you thanks for your diverse creation, filled with purposeful interdependence. Thank you for creating in us an innate desire to live in community with a need for the gifts of others. Thank you for the freedom to be who we truly are, imperfect in body and mind, dependent, fallible, always needing help, and always needed to help those around us. You, God, whole and holy, live in the eternal community of triune love and call us, limited and dependent as we are, into community with you. You give and ask of us ever-flowing mercy, not unblemished sacrifice. This is why the whole universe worships you. This is why we join with all of heaven and earth to praise you in an endless chorus of praise. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might. Holy are you, God, and blessed is your Son, Jesus the Christ, who teaches us the way of mercy and not sacrifice. We bless you, O God, because it is in mercy and not sacrifice that Jesus taught his disciples not to depend on the money or the gifts that they could offer, but on the hospitality and gifts of others. We give you thanks, O God, because it is in mercy and not sacrifice that Jesus taught his disciples not to depend on their own power to obtain approval, but to depend on the power and mercy of others. We praise your name, O God, because it is in mercy and not sacrifice that Jesus taught his disciples not to seek respectability, but to connect with all people, including sinners and outcasts who were often told that they could not look to heaven for help. We glorify you, O God, because it is in mercy and not sacrifice that Jesus taught his disciples not to seek intellectual, political, or physical superiority, but to be the servant of all, of every ability, even washing their feet. For it was in mercy and not sacrifice that Jesus took bread unable to rise, blessed you for it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, and it is in mercy and not sacrifice that Jesus took a cup of wine from the hastily prepared table and then gave it to his disciples, saying, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood, claiming divine promise of forgiveness for you. And so we, subjects of God's mercy in Christ, and no longer objects of sacrifice despite the world's labeling, give you ourselves, our differently abled souls and bodies, a fragrant offering of praise and thanksgiving as we proclaim the mystery of our faith. O fount of courage, breeze of hope, breath of mercy, stir into these imperfect gifts of bread and cup the merciful presence of the body and blood of Jesus Christ to bless our lives. Fount of courage, breeze of hope, breath of mercy, stir the imperfect gift of our lives into the merciful presence of the church, the body and bride of Christ to bless the world. Fount of courage, breeze of hope, breath of mercy, slake the thirsty, the overlooked and the ignored. Refresh the wearied, the abused and the shunned. Breathe life into the dying, the silenced and those left for dead, so that here and now, as in the age to come, all flesh in all conditions may confess your redeeming love. All this we lift to you, God, and we pray in the name of the Trinity, love of Father, of Spirit, of Son, love of Father for Son and Spirit, love of Son for Spirit and Father, love of Spirit for Father and Son, love of three in one for all, and mercy over all, ever abounding. Amen. Friends, just a couple reminders as we prepare to take communion together. First is that communion in the United Methodist Church is open to everyone. You do not need to be a member of this church. You do not need to be a regular attender of any church. You are fully welcome in this space as you are. You are invited to use the center aisle to come forward where you will receive a piece of the bread. And then we have individual cups of grape juice. It is grape juice. It is not wine. So that's just a reminder for folks if you've not been in this space before. And when you've received in both kinds, you can use the side aisles to return to your seat. I would invite you, if you so desire, to come and dip your hand in the waters of baptism to remind yourselves of your own baptism and your commitment to being part of the family of God. Know that if mobility is an issue for you, you're more at the end, I'll sort of do a scan. It's not to say, oh, you didn't come up for communion. It is a scan to make sure that there's nobody who is in need of a little bit of extra mobility help. So you let me know what you need, and we are here for it. But you are welcome in this space all of the time, for this is God's table. It does not belong to us. So come as you are ready. Yes. Come as you are ready. The body of Christ broken for you. Thank you. As we move forward to our time of prayer, are there any prayer requests that should be lifted for the good of the order? Okay, let's pray. Holy, gracious, and eternal God, we give you thanks. We give you thanks for the ways that you have blessed and changed our lives, for the spaces and the places where we can see you. We pray, God, for transitions, for the next thing that will come. We ask for you to be present in our time to reduce our anxiety. God, we pray for the political scope and adventure that is in our country. We pray for your graciousness and your love and your mercy to prevail in all spaces. We pray, God, for the places in which we are struggling, where the world is crying out for you. We pray, Lord, for you to help us to remember that we are not alone, that all things are in your hands. And even when we cannot find the words to say aloud, that you know what is deep in our hearts. All of this, God, we lift to you in the name of your Son, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Friends, I invite you to remain seated, but join us in our singing of the Lord's Prayer. Stand in body or spirit and join us in our closing hymn this morning. It's number 347 in your red hymnals or up on the screen, Spirit Song.
Thank you.
Friends, may you go from this place knowing that you are loved beyond a shadow of a doubt, that God, who knows you and formed you and breathed the breath of life into you, will always be present for you. And may you go out into the world spreading the good news of belonging, of love, of a radical God who says all are welcome. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.